Father, in the name of Jesus, we just stand before you, Lord. We declare that you are great. That, Lord, in the midst of everything, that you are great, Father. That you are for us and not against us. That greater is he that is in us that is in the world. And we are thankful, Father, for everything that you've done in our lives and everything that you're going to do, Father God. Because you are faithful and you are true to your word, my God. And right now, we just commit the rest of this service in your hands. Holy Spirit, do what you do. Arrest hearts in this place. Let every heart be open to what you want to speak about today, Lord. Because we give you all the honor. We give you all the glory. And in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody says, amen. God bless you. Amen. Let's make some noise for Jesus. Amen. You can take your seats this afternoon. Just as we continue in our series of the Faith Moves, Pastor Paul preached a powerful message this morning about faith and money. And you can go to, on YouTube, subscribe to our YouTube page at Victory Outreach Manchester, where you can get all our messages and that. And I encourage you that, you know what, you can watch your messages going to your work or in your house during the week and that. But I would encourage you, you know what, to subscribe to those messages, because especially this morning, that was a powerful message this morning about faith and money. And I want to continue talking about on that theme this afternoon. And I want to be looking at managing your finances the Jesus way. Everybody say the Jesus way. Because how many know that we can sometimes manage things our way? But when you manage things the Jesus way, we manage things the correct way. And there's a portion of scripture that I want to read. Read in the book of Luke, chapter 12. You can turn there. I'm going to be reading a few portions of scripture here. And it's in Luke, chapter 12. And it's reading from verse 13. And it says, then someone called from the crowd, "Teacher, please tell my brother to divide our father's estate with me." Jesus replied, "Friend, who made me a judge over you to decide such things at that?" Then he said, "Beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you own." Then he told them a story. A rich young man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. He said to himself, "What should I do? I don't have room for all my crops." Then he said, "I know, I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy, eat, drink, and be merry." But God said to him, "You fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything? Who will get everything you worked for?" Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God. Then turning to his disciples, Jesus said, "This is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life, whether you have enough food to eat or enough clothes to wear. For life is more than food, and your body is more than clothing. Look at the ravens, they don't plant or harvest or store food in the barns, for God feeds them. And you are far more valuable to him than any birds. Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And if worry can't accomplish a little thing like that, then what's the use of worrying over bigger things? Look at the lilies, how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. And if God cares so wonderfully for flowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? And don't be concerned about what to eat and what to drink. Don't worry about such things. These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers all over the world. But your Father already knows your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else, and he will give you everything you need. So don't be afraid, little flock, for it gives your Father great happiness to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions to give to those in need. This will store up treasure for you in heaven. And then the purses of heaven never get old or develop holes. Your treasure will be safe. No thief can steal it, and no moth can destroy it. And verse 34 says, wherever your treasure is, there the desires of your hearts will also be. That's a long portion of scripture that I've read here this afternoon. But what I want to be focusing on is managing your finances the Jesus way. Because did you know that in the New Testament, Jesus said more about money than he did about heaven and hell put together? He talked about finances all the time. Out of his 38 parables, 16 of them are about finances and how to use them and how to keep them from using and abusing you. Get this, in the New Testament, there are 500 verses on prayer, less than 500 verses on faith, but more than 2,000 dealing with financial matters. Because how many know that our finances and what we do is important to Jesus, amen? Because how many know that he's the one that blesses us and he's the one that provides for us and he's the one that takes care of us and opens doors for us? Because when it comes to finances, we either do it the Jesus way, or what tends to happen in today's culture, that there's an urgency that people start to do it their own way. Because when you do it the Jesus way, then you're trusting in him with everything you've got. But when you do it your own way, we're holding back and saving up for a rainy day, or holding things back and maybe neglecting the things of God. I love it. Control is such a thing, it's such a stronghold today, that it's easy to get credit and it's easy to get loans on buy now and pay later on things that we don't really need because of such media pressure and peer pressure. But I believe it's down to lack of self-control. I believe it's a lack of self-control that we can have sometimes. And I remember watching this documentary on the TV about supermarkets and what they do, what their marketing strategy is. When you walk into a supermarket, there's usually a special offers. You walk in, there's a big aisle that's special offers, and it's like they're advertising it as something that you need right now. It's that special thing. And these companies pay a large amount of money for a short period of time just to get a part in the shop, a floor space that where everyone's going to walk by and it's going to be attracting to them. I don't know about you, if you've ever been in a shop and you've maybe went for a loaf of bread or you've maybe went for a pint of milk and all of a sudden you've come back with a bag of shopping. Has anybody ever done that in God's house? I know Simone gives me a row for it all the time because I'll go up for a loaf and I'll come back with all this stuff and she'll say, but you don't really, really need it. And I'll always say, you know what? But it was on special, love. We'll need it one day. And it's a distraction, it's a tactics, it's a, I believe, a plot that tries to get us to be under their control, where God wants us to be free, especially when it comes to the area of giving, when it comes to the area of our finances and what we do with our finances, who we trust with our finances, what we spend our finances on. Because we don't serve a controlling God. We serve a God of grace and a God that enables us and a God that makes a way for us. But now, not to say that finances is the most important subject in Scripture, but it's a critical issue and the thing that often enslaves our hearts when God wants to own all that we are. And in these portions of Scripture I read in the book of Luke, I believe there's a few principles that we can take on board today as a church and we can take on board individually. Because how many know that God wants us to be good stewards of what he entrusts to us? He wants us to be responsible of what he places in our life because he places it in our life because he gives us a seed. Because how many know that there's always a need for that seed? There's always a need for that seed, but the world will tell you there's always a need for greed. There's always a need for having more and having more. And my first principle today is that more is not always better. More is not always better. Luke 12:15 said, then he said, beware, guard against every kind of greed. Life is not measured by how much you own. But in the world, that's contrary to that. In the world, you're measured on how much you own. You're measured on how much money you have. You're measured on your worth and your status in that place. And I was reading up the other day there about football players and the transfer market and how much some players go for. And I was reading up and I was looking at who was the actual first £1 million British player. And it was a way back in 1980 and it was a man called Trevor Stevens. And he was the first £1 million player in Britain. But really, it was 999,900 because the manager didn't want him to get a big ego. Because the manager didn't want him to be all focused on that he was the first million player. But you look at that now in today's society, how much some of their players go for. Like Pastor Paul says, you'll see a lot of them, it's about the name on the back and it's not really about the name on the chest, amen. But how many know that God wants us to reverse that? That God, it's all about, it's about the heart. It's about serving God. It's about trusting God. It's about whatever God places you, whatever God gives you, it's for a reason. It's not to build you up. It's not to make you wealthy. But if you are wealthy, that's good. But you still have a responsibility with what God gives you, because there's always a mission for what he gives you. There's always something that he wants you to do with what he gives you. That's why he talks about being faithful in the little before you can be faithful in the much. Because how can he trust you with much if you squander the little? How can he trust you with much if you don't even take care of business with the little? That if you just blank things and you don't turn up to things and you don't do things with the little that he's given you. See, Jesus says that the good life has nothing to do with being wealthy. So be on our guard against greed, desiring for what we don't have. We see that in advertisement all the time when you're driving in your car and you see the big billboards and it's the latest flashy car, it's the latest flashy trainers, and all of a sudden you might be driving in your car and you feel so inadequate because your car does not match up to that one in the billboard. Then all of a sudden there's a desire, I wonder if I could get that car. I wonder if I could manage to get that car or get that latest trainers to make myself feel good. Because how many know that it's not about making yourself feel good? It's all about God because he is good, amen? It's all about God because he is good. See, how do you respond to those constant pressures to buy? How do you respond when there's so much things? I remember my kids growing up, and I remember when they were younger and that, you could easily just get them a bit of stuff that was a bit cheaper, maybe a bit trainers were a bit cheaper. Then they start to go to school and they start asking for the brands. They start asking, it's not about the Adidas 5-stripe. No, they want the real Adidas, amen. They want the real Nike Air Max, and they want the real stuff. Because when they're younger, we can sort of give them the other stuff. But how many know that when they grow up, there's such a pressure on them? And that's like in society, there's such a pressure to get stuff. There's such a pressure to accumulate stuff. There's such a pressure to get debt and to get more credit. There's such a pressure. You see it, you click on, and always guaranteed the week before the payday at the end of the month, there's always payday specials. Do you see them on the web? Payday specials. Get these trainers on a payday special. Or get this new dress on a payday special. And there's always seems to be deals when it's payday, because it's always trying to tell you that you need to get more and you need to get more and you need to get more. But how many know that we need to learn to blank and tune out those and the enticements and live to concentrate on truly fulfilling, living a relationship with God and doing his work? We should be looking for opportunities where we can sow back into the kingdom. Looking for opportunities where we can sow back in when he's been so good to us. He's been so good to us. You see, I know life isn't about stuff, but saying it and living it is very different. See, we can say it, but are you living it? We can say it, but we're living it, and all of a sudden we get this day, and we don't even really need it. We don't even really need it. See, more is not always better. I suggest that, you know what, you maybe have loads of money in your bank, but you might have poverty in your soul. See, you maybe have all the money, you maybe have all the things, but there could be poverty in your soul because you're not doing the things that God desires from you. And it creates a poverty in our souls. Yeah, we might have all the money and we might have all the fancy stuff and we might have all that, but there's poverty in your soul. There's an emptiness in your soul because you know you should be doing something different with what God blesses you. See, that's what God wants us to do. I love what it says in Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. It says, remember the Lord your God. He is the one who gives you power to be successful in order to fulfill the covenant he confirmed to your ancestors with an oath. Notice he doesn't say he gives you the power to be successful to keep it all to yourself. He doesn't give you the power. He doesn't give you that promotion to keep it all to yourself. He doesn't give you that. He doesn't bless you all to keep it to yourself. See, he blesses you because there's something that he has in store for you. There's somewhere that he wants to position you. There's somewhere where he wants to place you in this society, in this generation. We see the young people rising up in the church. We see the third wave. We see the gang rising up. And you know what? What a blessing. But my prayer is that the gang can get a hold of always trusting God with the finances, like they did back in 1967 with Pastor Sonny and with the elders. They were always stepping out, trusting God for finances. And I really believe that this young generation have to understand the principles and the values when it comes to finances, that it's not all about having too much, but it's serving the God of more than enough. That as quick as you give it out, he will always be faithful to bless you back. See, as long as you keep giving, he'll keep supplying. As long as you keep sowing, he'll keep supplying to you. You will never run out of seed as long as you trust Jesus and always put him first. See, he doesn't, and also it says in Proverbs 11 verse 24, it says, give freely and become more wealthy. But I love the second part of that, and it says, be stingy and lose everything. It's the word of God. It says, give freely and become more wealthy. Be stingy and lose everything. See, when you start to trust in yourself, when you start to make decisions over you, being led by yourself, how many know that those decisions always end up crashing and getting you in trouble? See, you end up losing everything when you start to lean on your own understanding. But the Bible's clear and it says, give freely and become more wealthy. See, it's God's plan. God's plan for us to be wealthy. God's plan for us to prosper. God's plan for us to be in that place where we're always looking for opportunities to be able to bless and to be able to sow and to be able to bless other people with God has given us. See, that's what I love about this church. That's what I love about Pastor Paul and Sister Vicky. They bless, they're givers. They're always sowing. They're not interested in what they've got left because they're always looking for opportunities where to sow. And we see that they have a blessed life. Why? Because they've learned the principle of trusting God with their finances. Not trusting yourself, but trusting God. It doesn't matter what everyone else is doing. It doesn't matter what your family are saying. It doesn't matter what people even at your workplace is saying, but what matters is what the Bible says and what Jesus says. And he says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, in all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall make your path straight. See, it's not about having too much. It's not about having that too much so you become fat. But you're just sitting there and you're just accumulating your wealth and you're sitting there with your little piles. My precious, my precious, my precious, my precious. And you're counting how much you've got and what you're going to, but you're actually missing what God's trying to say to you. He's getting you to say to you, open your eyes, there's a need out there. Open your eyes, there are places where you can sow. Open your eyes, there's people out there in a need, and God has given you a seed to supply that need. See, and also I believe that another principle is that it says is that hoarding is for fools. Hoarding is for fools. And when I looked up that word hoarding in the Oxford Dictionary, it says an act of collecting large amounts of something and keeping it for yourself, often in a secret place. Or a mental condition that makes someone want to keep a large number of things that are not needed or have no value. How many people have got that cupboard where you just put things in that you're going to fix one day? Or you've got that thing that you know what? And I'll make a disclaimer, and Pastor Paul has it said before, if a man says he's going to fix it, you don't need to ask him every 6 months, he will. I say that to my wife all the time, you don't need to keep going every year, I will do it. But sometimes we can hoard stuff. Sometimes we can keep things back in. Because at the time, there's a great intention. Say, I'll use that one day. Or I'll use that one day. Or I'll fix that one day. Or I'll make sure that changes one day. And we put it away and we store it away and we stick it away. And at the end of the day, we've no need for it. We've no need for it. It's just taking up space. And in the parable, in verse 16, Jesus calls a person a fool who hoards his income for himself and doesn't generously share it, so is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. Here, Jesus in this matter, he's asking, what are you doing for that? Life is suddenly over and you've invested in what doesn't last. It's foolish. I heard a great joke the other day there about the rich man who was on his deathbed, and he was very rich, very, very rich man. So he decided and said, you know what, I'm going to take some of this with me. So he gets his suitcase and he goes to his safe and he opens up his safe and he gets 3 bars of gold, puts them in his safe, gets the handcuffs it to himself, lies in his bed, then he passes away. So he's standing there in front of the pearl gates, and there's St. Peter, and he's like, wow, what's that you've got there, sir? He's like, all proud of himself. Takes the handcuffs up, opens it up, 3 bars of gold. And Peter went like, yes, thank you for bringing up some new pavement for us. Because it says in Revelations 21, verse 21, the 12 gates were made of pearls, each gate from a single pearl, and the main street was pure gold and as clear as glass. See, when you get to heaven, it's the streets that are lined with gold, not your pockets. Amen. When you get to heaven, it's the streets with the pearls and the gold. You can't take it with you. You can't just go to heaven with it. So why don't you use it and be blessed and have some joy, have some fun, be great, have a great time with it, serving the Lord. We don't want to hold it back. See, the rich man in Jesus' story died before he could use what was stored in his big barns. See, there was no point in having all that stuff. He couldn't take it with him. See, sometimes we hold and we hold and we hold. And we use that famous phrase, I'm keeping it for a rainy day. But you live in Manchester, every day is rainy. Every day is rainy. So you should be using it today. You should be sowing it today. You should be investing in people today. You should be investing in the house that you're in today. That's what we should be doing. See, the rich man died before he could use it. See, preparing for life before death is wise, but neglecting life after death is a disaster. If you accumulate wealth only to enrich yourself with no concern for helping others, you will enter eternally empty-handed. See, the only thing that you can send on is souls. The only thing that you can send on is souls, amen? You can't send your finances, but that's why God wants us to trust in it now. That's why God wants us to step out now. I love what Jesus says about it in verse 22. He says, therefore, I say to you, don't worry about life, what you'll eat, nor about the body, or what you will put on. If then God so clothes the grass, which today is the field and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much will he clothe you? Then he says something that is so key. He says, O you of little faith. O you of little faith. See, Jesus is saying, you don't trust me very much, do you? When he's telling them, oh, you of little faith, when you're worrying about what you're going to wear, when you're worrying about what you're going to eat, when you're worrying about what you need to save up for, he's saying, oh, you of little faith, you're not trusting me. You're not believing me. You're not taking my word and you're not applying my word to your life. See, the whole matter of giving is about faith. When the baskets go round every week at church, we make a choice either to give to God or you know what, or to give to ourselves. We make that choice. We make that decision every time when it comes, when God blesses you, when you get your wages, when he provides for you. You have a choice. You have a decision at that moment of what you will do. You'll either hoard it for yourself, or you'll trust in God and you'll take him at his word and you'll give to the kingdom of God. I thank God that I learned that principle of being able to give. I thank God that, you know what, that I have great examples of men and women that are givers, because they'll never ask you to do something that they're not prepared to do themselves. See, we need to be at that place where we are trusting God in stepping out, because faith moves the hand of God. But fear will always keep your hand closed. See, faith will move the hand of God, but fear will keep your hand closed. Because you don't want to let it go. Maybe you've been let down before. Maybe you've had a bad experience before. Maybe you've saw some bad critics before. But I want to tell you today that as long as you let go, then God can keep supplying. See, there's nothing wrong with the supply, but the problem is with the person that's holding it. See, the reason why you might be struggling, or the reason why that you might not be as blessed as you should be right now, is because you're holding on to something. You're holding on to that when all the time the Lord is saying, oh, you of little faith, just let go and let me take control. Because as long as you seek first the kingdom, he will always take care of you. He will always take care of you. See, really the question is, does God have everything that belongs to you? See, everything that we have belongs to God. But does everything that you have belong to God? See, we have to ask ourselves that. Is there stuff that we're holding back from God? Especially finances. That's why it's such a hard subject. That's why it's such a hard thing. Because when the minute you mention finances, sometimes people just close up. They start to think, oh no, they're going to ask for an offering. They're going to ask for a pledge, or they're going to ask for this. No, all God is asking for is your heart. That's all he's asking for is your heart. Because he wants you to trust him, and he doesn't want you to hold nothing back, because he's never held nothing back from you. And we have to remember that this morning. And also, the next principle, you can't outgive God. How many know that you cannot outgive God? But Jesus isn't telling us to give generously because he wants us to sweat. He's not telling you to trust in him because he wants you on tender hooks. Because when you know that you know that you know that the minute you're released and you've got a peace that passes all understanding, that if God said it, then God will fulfill it. If God's promised it, then God will always come through. God is not like man that will lie, but if God has promised you, he will always come through to his promises, especially in the area of finances. Especially in the area of finances. I like the story of the widow in the Bible. When it comes to the time of the offering, and all the throw in the large amounts, and they throw in the big large amounts of money, and I can imagine the scenario. I can imagine they're there and they're getting their amounts and they're making sure everybody sees their large amounts, and they're throwing them in, and there comes this little widow, and she's got a couple of coins, and she puts them in, all that she had, she puts them in. And why does she put them in? Because you don't give to make yourself look good. You give because God is good. See, you don't give to make yourself look good. Look how much I've given this week, Pastor. Check my tithe. Look how much I've given. Wow, look at this big check. Whoa, stand back. I've got a big check. Excuse me, I need two envelopes because that envelope's not enough for what I'm giving this month. And it can be like that sometimes. But it's not about giving to make yourself look good. It's about giving because God is good. And it says in Luke 6, verse 38, it says, give and you will receive. Your gift will return in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount that you give will determine the amount that you give back. Have you ever given generously out of sacrifice and seen God multiply it? Has there ever been a time in your life when you've given, God came through? Or let me ask you this question, has there ever been a time when you've gave and God's not come through? Has there ever been a time that you've stepped out in faith and you've sacrificed giving and God's never come through in some shape, size or form? I don't believe there's anybody in this place that could stand up and say, yes, that's me, because that's not God. See, when you step out sacrificially, when you trust God sacrificially, and you're especially in your finances, God will always come through. See, God will multiply always back in blessing. And I've saw it time and time, and I had the privilege of working in the financing. I remember Pastor Paul was a man of faith, and he taught me faith. He always taught me faith about trusting God for finances, trusting God that God will always come through. It doesn't matter what you see in the natural eye. God will always come through. It doesn't matter what's in front of you. God will always come through. And I used to see it time after time, and he would say, step out in this and step out in that. Then the minute you step out, you're in God's zone. See, the minute when you stay hold back, you're in your own zone. But the minute that you step out, you're in God's zone. And when you're in God's zone, God will always bless your sacrifice. He will always bless you when you step out. It doesn't matter what you see in the natural. It doesn't matter what you've got in front of you. Well, what matters is who's behind you and who's in you and who's for you and who's with you and who'll supply to you. That's what matters. We need to be a generation that's sacrificially given, always stepping out and trusting God. Always stepping out and trusting God. We can never trust in ourselves. We can never trust in ourselves. See, God will never be in debt position to you. God will never be in debt to you. You can never outgive God. You can never ever step out and God will never come through, because God will always come through. But the problem is that sometimes fear stops us stepping out. Sometimes pride will stop us stepping out. Sometimes greed will stop us stepping out. Sometimes even times of you've been rejected or whatever, or sometimes you've suffered, or sometimes there's been an issue, that issue will control you and it'll stop you stepping out and trusting God, especially in the area of our finances. See, it's a faith thing. It's a faith thing, church. It's not a money thing. It's not a Victory Outreach Manchester thing. It's a kingdom, it's a faith thing. That if you can get a hold of faith, if you can take that faith, because the Bible says it's impossible to please God without it. You can't please God without it. So why don't we use it? Why don't we flex that faith muscle? Why don't we build up our faith? We've all been given a measurement of faith. We've all been given that little bit of faith. But it's up to us to grow it. It's up to us to see the hand of God move in certain areas that builds your faith and it builds your character and it builds your trust in Him. It builds your trust when God comes through, because it gives you a testimony of how good He is. When God comes through, it gives you a testimony of how amazing He is, because God will always come through. He will always come through, church. You don't need to worry about that. He will always come through. I learned in the men's home about giving. I thank God for the men's home. I thank God that the men's home broke me and smashed me and built me up into a man of God. But I remember the principle I learned about giving. I remember we got a little bit money in the fortnight and I had a little bit left. And I remember saying, giving the paying their contributions and different things and had a little bit left. And I remember the director says, well, that's your tithing that now then. And it left me with nothing. It left me with a couple of pounds, sorry. And it was Saturday shopping day, and I wanted some chips. I wanted some munch. I wanted some food. And I remember going up and chapping the director's door and said, see that money I gave you? Is there any chance I can get it back? He said, that's your tithe money, brother. I said, aye, but God will understand. I said, I'm hungry. I said, look at me, I need some food. I want to go to the chippy. I want to get some munch. I want to get some snacks. And I was getting a bit of an argument. And I was getting upset. And I was saying, but it's my money. It's my money. And he's like, no, bro. You've gave it to God. It's His. I was like, no, that's wrong. He's like, no, it's right. And there was this argument. There was an argument and an argument. And I end up storming off. All right, then. I'm going to leave. Whatever. But I didn't leave, thank God. And I remember I went to church the next morning. And I was sitting in there. And Pastor Mitchell went up and started to preaching. And he started preaching, and the name of the message was, don't rob God of your tithes and offering. And I remember the director turning around laughing at me. I was like, got it. So many know that sometimes once you get it, you get it. See, once you understand faith, you get it. Once you've seen God move in your life before, you get it. Once God's come through once, and God's come through twice, and God's come through three times, then you've got no problem of stepping out. You've got no problem of stepping out. The problem is sometimes that we don't step out is because we get stuck in a mindset. We get stuck in a mindset. A mindset that's trying to work it out, and a mindset that's trying to think it out. But faith doesn't work like that. Faith is simply when God says it, you just obey it. God says it and you just obey it and you just step out. And I thank God for that, that I've had to learn those lessons over the years. And the last principle is, if my money is for self, my heart is not for God. If my money is for self, my heart is not for God. It says in verse 32, it says, but seek first the kingdom of God and all these things shall be added to you. On the heels of this familiar verse, Jesus says these tender words, do not fear, little flock. And I read the Bible so many times and I'd never ever saw this little bit of scripture when it says, do not fear, little flock. And it's the only place you can find it is in the New Testament, in this portion of scripture. And you can look at most translations and it all says the same thing about do not fear, little flock. And I believe that he's calling us the little flock because how many know that when it comes to finances, sometimes it can be a very tender thing. When it's talking about money, it can be a very tender thing. And I believe that Jesus knows that we can get really protective when our money is in our hands. We can become very protective. Well, I've worked for it all week, it's mine. I've done that work, it's mine. I made this, it's mine. And we become very protective of what we think is ours. But really, God is saying, you know what? He says, do not fear. And sometimes we can say, oh no, what if I go without? What if my children go without? What if this goes without? But he says something key. He says, don't fear, little flock, for it's God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. It's God's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. See, it's God's good pleasure to provide for his children. It's God's good pleasure to get you that promotion at your workplace. It's God's good pleasure to open the door for you in that situation. It's God's good pleasure. But sometimes we can be so foolish and grip so tightly to a little bit of resources. In disobedience, we shut ourselves out from the resources of God. See, I believe today, church, that you know what? That as we heard Pastor Paul say earlier, that the tables have turned. The tables have turned. And I believe that's in regard to our finances also, that the tables have turned. And I believe that there's people in this place that God is going to bless you so much. That he wants to bless you so much. That there's things that he wants to bless you with. There's things that he wants to provide for you. There's things that he wants to give you. But we have to get those principles right. We have to be a people that say, you know what? I'm putting God first. See, what Jesus is meaning is don't let your buying habits leave you in a position where you can't give. And as we stand to our feet this afternoon, I want to ask you a question. Where are you when it comes to finances? Where are you when it comes to what you do with the money that God blesses you? What you do with the finances? We heard Pastor say some statistics, I think it was the first service, but if you look at it, it's like 4 out of every 10 are givers in the church. What about the rest? What about the rest? The tables have turned, the chains have been broken. But you have a responsibility to trust God. You have a responsibility to trust in him. And I believe that today at this altar that chains can be broken of that poverty mindset. Because sometimes that can be a stronghold, a poverty mindset. And also I believe that today that you know what, that there's some thinking that needs to be realigned. Stop trying to work it out. Trust God. Stop trying to make it happen. Trust God. Stop trying to work it out yourself and trying to make things happen yourself. And it's trust God. Trust God in your finances. Trust God in what he gives you. Trust him. And watch what God does in your life. I don't know about you, but I want to be blessed. How many people want to be blessed in God's house? How many people say, you know what, I want to be blessed. I want to have a blessed life. But sometimes the biggest blockage to that blessing is ourself. Sometimes the biggest blockage to that blessing is ourself, because we'll not let go of certain things. That we hold on and we don't trust God. And as the worship team get ready to lead us in worship, I want to invite us to come to the altar. You know what? And I want us just to really worship Jesus. Because at the end of the day, He's the one that deserves all the glory. He's the one that provides for us. Maybe you need to come and repent today. Maybe you've been holding back. Maybe you've stopped giving for a season. Maybe you've not been trusting God, especially in the area of your finances. Then you need to come today and repent. You need to come today and repent, because the tables have turned. The tables have turned in your life, and there's going to be opportunities where God wants to bless you. God wants to provide for you. God wants to take care of you. But you have to take care of His business. And as the worship team sing,
Outreach Manchester is a family in the city, and we are here for you. Visit us every Sunday at 10 a.m. and 12 p.m. or go to vomanchester.org for more information.